I will do anything just to see you, to behold you as my king. I want to be where you are. God, I thank you for this opportunity. For once again, you've chosen perfect me to be a vessel of your perfect word. God, while I've studied and while I've prepared, I'm smart enough to know I need your anointing. Send your power, your preaching power once more. Send your healing power in your word, your delivering power, your saving grace that rides on the wings of your perfect word. And we'll be obedient to that which you've charged us with. And through our obedience, you'll get all of the glory. We thank you and praise you. In the name of Jesus Christ, and all of God's people say amen.
Amen.
Why don't you clap your hands and give God some praise. Certainly endeavored to do what we were put up to do. We thank God for the opportunity to be here. I am not ignorant of the privilege, for this pulpit has been graced by some great men, not the least of which is the Reverend, late Reverend G. Daniel Jones, and we celebrate him. We celebrate your interim pastor, Pastor Quentin Robertson, for the invitation. Thank God for my pastor in his absence. Superintendent Milton Baxter for allowing me to leave on this Sunday morning, and for my friend and brother, Brother Dwayne Bridgman, who accompanied me. And we thank God for all of you. The scripture text for this morning has already been read for your hearing. And there are some things, I'm sure by now you recognize that I am a Pentecostal, a holy roller. Unashamedly, I said that to say there are some things that are seemingly similar across denominations in this black church. And I'm sure, like me, you got goosebumps watching our president sing. He recognized that the organist would back him up. I prefer to think that he didn't know. The spontaneity of the moment in my mind makes it more exciting to remember. And furthermore, as he ramped up and called out the names, how he was allowed to hoop the names of those who we mourn. Because the organist, a black church organist, was able to chime in and assist the preacher. There were some things that, regardless of denomination, seem similar. However, we must recognize that nothing on this earth really stays the same. Our church practices, even our music changes. There was a time when a bass and a guitar and Hammond organ would have been shunned at in our churches. And we live in a day and a time when so much information, too much information, in fact, is at our fingertips. If you don't believe me, log on to your Facebook account and see everybody's business that they uploaded this morning. Sometimes all of the information that we can be inundated with makes it a lot to think about. It can be overwhelming. We have a 24-hour news cycle, and if you don't want to watch TV, get on Twitter for those of you who are social network gurus like myself. I remember I found out Michael Jackson had passed, not from my television, but I was scrolling through my Twitter timeline, and all of a sudden MJ and Michael Jackson and hashtag Thriller started to pop up. We live in a day and an age when so much information, push alerts on our phone, to tell us everything from a tornado warning to the score of the Warriors and Cavaliers game. All of this can often seem like a lot to have to swirl in our minds, and it can sometimes appear as if there is no consistency. The president's poll numbers up and his poll numbers down. Peace 1 minute and chaos the next. But there was most likely a lot going on through the minds of these two disciples as they walked on the road to a place called Emmaus. And over the course of 3 days, they had seen Jesus captured, crucified, and buried. It would have been different if they were common folk who just happened to be strolling through Jerusalem when all of these things were happening. But the Bible makes it clear that these were not just common folk. They were men who were among Jesus' followers. And they knew him. There are a lot of people who know about him, who are just familiar with Jesus, who are casual acquaintances of our Lord. But these were not so. These were men who knew him, who were among his followers, who had trailed behind in the parade. These were not random people walking, but people who had been around him and exposed to him and his teaching, his power. They were church folk. Still, even though they had been around Jesus in this particular instance and on this particular journey, they weren't aware that Jesus was walking right next to them. In other words, they knew him in their present situation. Is there anybody that can identify with him? You know him, and you know what he's able to do. Matter of fact, you've seen him before. Maybe he healed a grandmommy. Maybe he paid a bill in a tight financial squeeze. Maybe he brought a child or a loved one back from the brink of addiction. But whatever it is, you saw him do it. Yet at this time, in this situation, for some reason, you can't see him in this situation. As the men were walking, Jesus came up to them and began to talk with them. And Jesus asked them, I know I'm in a Baptist church, but I feel mighty good right now. Y'all keep amening me like this. We might just preach. Jesus asked them, what are you discussing that has you so sad? The disciple named Cleopas had to stop and ask Jesus, are you a stranger around here? Are you new to town? Have you not seen the headline on the newspaper? Clearly you can't be from around here because of Sally, Ray, JoJo, everybody's been sitting around talking about this thing. Are you a stranger around here? Because only someone who was new to town would be unaware of the things that have us with our heads hanging down. Cleopas asked Jesus, don't you know about everything that's taken place around here in the last 3 days? And Jesus, being clever as he was, Jesus being wise as he was, responded with his own question. What things? What things? But I don't want you to get it twisted. Just because Jesus responded with the question, what things, didn't mean he didn't already know the answer to the question. Every once in a while, he'll ask us questions to get our response. But when Jesus asked his disciples, who do men say that I am? He already knew what they thought. Some thought he was Elijah. Some thought he was one of the prophets. He already knew. He just wanted to hear the response. But when he found women outside of his empty tomb, why are you crying? Who are you seeking? But the truth is, he already knew the answer. And here, even, he also knew the answer. The road to Emmaus. He already knew what they were thinking about, but he had to ask the question anyway, and he does the same thing in our lives. He is the all-knowing, the all-seeing, the ever-present. Clearly he knows what you're going through. Clearly he knows what has you agonized. You are astute and educated. I know you've got a good job and a beautiful wife and a beautiful husband, but every once in a while there are some things that you're going through. Just be reminded, he already knows, even though he wants you to tell him what he's able to do in this situation. He wants you to speak back to him the faith that he hopes you have, that he's able to intervene, no matter what it is. He does the same thing in our lives, questions that he knows the answer to. He asks them of us, who am I to you? Why do you have your head hanging down? Know ye not who I am and what I can do? The truth is, these disciples should have been well aware of everything that happened to Jesus, because Jesus had taught them about his death and resurrection. Multiple times in my Bible, three times, less than a year before all of these events, he states, I'm going to be betrayed. They're going to crucify me. On the third day, I'll be raised to life. You know, no secret. It almost days, but they had forgotten that Jesus said, if you destroy it, I'm going to rise it back up again. He explained how he was only with them for a short time. I am a Star Wars fan. Do I have any Star Wars fans in the building? But every once in a while, I'm reminded of what Obi-Wan Kenobi, if you're not a Star Wars fan, bear with me. I'm preaching still.
YouTube.
was that my prayer life was, church was. So often when we're going through, we dwell on the was. But here's the problem with dwelling on the was. When you dwell and focus and settle and rest and thrive in the was, you forget about the is. But I'm so glad today I serve a God who not only was, but he was and he is the God. And just as he was breaking the bread, God revealed to the two men who he really was. Isn't that so coincidental? Because you see, sometimes it's in the process of being broken that we really see who God is. Sometimes I can't really see God until something breaks. Sometimes what is a peaceful and orderly family union has to break up.
Still a question answerer, and he's still in.
whatever it is. I came to tell you there's still a fountain filled with blood, drawn from a man's vein, and sinners plunge beneath the flood and lose all their guilty stains. Don't cry about it, don't worry about it, give it to Jesus. Don't agonize over it, don't stress over it, give it to Jesus. Don't be depressed about it, give it to Jesus, because He still is. Come on and clap your hands and give God some praise.
Church home. The doors of the church